Dinner Conversations is brought to you by Food for the Hungry, an incredible relief and community development organization serving those with physical and spiritual needs around the world for 50 years this year.
Help us as we help our friends at Food for the Hungry save thousands of lives in Ethiopia today by considering a generous gift.
A gift that will be matched 22 times.
Your one-time gift will make an eternal difference. So visit fh.org/dinner to give now.
Well, we had a fabulous conversation with Leigh Nash about raising teenagers. Now, you might know her from Sixpence, None the Richer.
Kiss
but
me.
She's also got kids.
One.
Well, she's got one kid.
So we should call it Raising Teenager.
So, yeah. But,
absolutely. I also had a great conversation. Leigh talked about what it is to raise children as they're coming up through their teen years. Gave us the perspective of a parent. But I sat down with Caroline Breen. Of course, we film right here in David and Shelley Breen's house. Caroline is their daughter who just graduated from high school, 18 years old. And so we talked to her about what is it like to be a teenager in relationship with her parents. So it's a really cool episode. And Leigh is hilarious.
She is hilarious. And there's one seat left at this table, and it's yours. So let's join the conversation.
You have rice on your nose. So, what kind of beast would I be if I didn't know
you're a good friend.
I am.
Yeah. We're from Texas.
Yeah. But let me, all three of us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. New Braunfels.
New Braunfels.
I spent so many happy, happy childhood summers.
With the rich kids.
No. Well.
I take that back.
Maybe.
I've got a big chip on my shoulder.
You do?
I'm working on it.
Oh. Because I didn't know that. I was, little. So we'd go there and it was an old wood shack house that my dad got on this Comal River, I guess, before the rich kids moved in. Mm. And we would float around there. And you get up and walk across the street and you start back where you left. Mm-hmm. You just do a circle.
Right. On the river?
Yes.
The river was a circle?
It was a horseshoe. Mm-hmm. Oh. And you'd cross the street and you'd do it for another hour and a half.
It's like a lazy river.
It is like a Huck Finn novel.
The Comal, I believe, is the shortest river in the world.
He didn't write any novels. Did
Starts
he?
And stops
Mark
in the same
Twain
town.
Novel.
Really?
Yeah. It's really...
I interrupted you, what?
Oh, it's okay.
No, sit down again.
I'm used to it. The Comal River is the shortest river in the world, I believe, that's still true.
You're right.
Because nothing gets shorter, right? It just is or it isn't.
True, yeah.
No, I mean, one just got shorter, so I don't know. But yeah, I think it's shorter than the shortest.
So you started in New Braunfels. You were born there.
Yeah. I was born in Houston, but I'm then raised in New Braunfels.
I was born in Houston.
Were you really?
Still live there.
And then where did you grow up?
Houston.
And you still live there?
We know about him. Yeah, what was your growing up experience?
Yeah. Well, I grew up in a Southern Baptist church. It was really a great church. It really was. My mom is a very spiritual woman. She's my hero. She's awesome. And my dad was also awesome. He passed away 12 years ago at 59. He was really young. Mm-hmm. But man, yeah, he just kept us spinning my whole childhood. He kept things very interesting and pretty traumatic. And my mom just kind of held the fort down. So of course, she's my hero.
Sure.
And, as I go through therapy, though, as an adult, the therapists are like, let's look at your mom a little better. Are you sure that she's the hero in this
picture? Sure. Yeah, yeah.
You're fired.
Yeah, exactly. Really? She is. Well, you do learn more. We learn more about our parents. As we get older, we begin to filter them through an adult perspective.
Right.
And it is, though, it takes like a little hump, I feel like, to get over what we idolize about our parents to then not idolize them. But once we do, they're more human. Don't you think they're more beautiful?
And that may be why the teen years, you go crazy because you start realizing they're a freak just like you.
Right. It's got to be alarming.
Maybe that's it.
Did you feel that way about it? Did you, when you were growing up, did you go, my dad is keeping us spinning and interesting? Or did you not really see it that way?
Well, I was reading about myself last night. I looked something up where you can put in your time of birth and your month of birth. Well, your birthday, it'll give you an alarming amount of information about yourself. And I found it to be really accurate. Yeah. And I was playing peacemaker, and I know that's a really common, you know, family of origin thing that can happen. I have one older sister that's 2 years older, but I was the peacemaker. So I was aware that, yeah, my dad was definitely making things really tough on my mom and therefore on us. But I was trying to protect her, trying to protect my sister, even trying to protect my dad to a certain extent, take care of everybody. So, you know, then you don't necessarily get parented certain ways. I'm just learning my sister and I were not parented to be respectful of our dad because he wasn't being worthy
of respect. Himself, maybe?
Well, yeah, he was being like an older brother.
Sure.
So now have a lot of leftover baggage from that. But I just kind of learned that recently with my therapist. He just, and yeah, he just said you were not parented to be respectful, so you're nasty to your husband.
Oh, really?
Interesting.
And so now I'm like really trying to be aware of that and show respect and also communicate with him. Hey, this is not really. I mean, it's my fault, but help me work. Natural. Help me work on this. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. So he's championing that counseling.
Yeah, I think so.
How's that going?
The counseling.
No, how's the.
How's it going?
You say your husband is helping
going
you.
Way better.
Now, will he bring it to your attention? There you go.
He's dealing with his own stuff. He lost his father a year ago, so he is in deep grief right now. So I know I'm bringing up all kinds of stuff at this table, but it's an interesting time for all of us in the household, my son, my husband, and myself, to work on ourselves and to not repeat history, for him to not... hold on to not letting go, which is what my husband's really good at. He lets go. I mean, he doesn't let go. So I'm trying to help him work through that. And at the same time, I'm trying to show my son model good behavior, like our good, you know, respectful treatment of the man of the household so that when he grows up, he is not used to a woman saying, you know,
diminishing
every 5 seconds. And I keep them laughing. I'm not an abusive Yes, I'm very funny.
So you're funny when you chew him out?
I'll do it with humor, and that's the same way it is in my sister's family, not to throw her under the bus.
Right.
But this summer, I just got back from Texas, and I gently brought it to her attention. Hey, we're both stuck in a family of origin situation. So let's just, you know, help each other break out of it a little bit.
Yeah, so there's a little bite to
it. How did she receive that?
A lot of bite. Yeah. She was wonderful about it because the way, I mean, I have to say because of the way I brought it.
You know, seriously, it is the way you bring these things up, which matters.
How?
Right.
You know, when you bring them up to the sister,
right,
and you're not condemning her, you're not accusing her, you're saying, hey, we're in this together.
Yeah.
And I've just learned this.
I definitely said, I just realized it about myself, so I wonder if that might be something that's happening here, too.
Okay.
So instead of saying, I noticed that you.
Yeah, or this is what I saw about you, instead of here's what I've discovered about me.
No, not at all.
Yeah, it's interesting, too, that for your son to be in a household with you and your husband who are wanting, like he's seeing examples of people who are not always perfect, who are not always making all the right decisions, who are not always being married well or parenting well, but are wanting to continue to be aware, self-aware. Yeah. Don't you think, like, I mean, my dad was a therapist, so I think I got a little leg up as far as an encouragement to be self-aware even at a younger age.
Wonderful.
But that's the most difficult thing, right? Is because if you become self-aware, I was talking to someone about this the other day. One, it's difficult. You have to be a critical thinker. You have to begin to want to actually think about things on a deeper level than just existing.
Absolutely.
Then that creates self-awareness. But then with that, that causes me to then be accountable to life.
Right.
That's not what most of us want. I don't want, that's not my favorite thing, to be accountable.
It's work.
Right.
It is. It's so much work. And I am very grateful, though, for whatever reason, part of what in my toolbox when I was born, I was given a lot of natural ability to be vulnerable. So that's given me, I think, a lot of shortcuts into wanting something deeper because I'm aware, like, oh my gosh, I'm even to a fault, like I'm trash.
Right.
And I know there's a difference between vulnerability and just having poor self-esteem.
Yeah. Well, you could be critical of yourself before anyone else.
I mean, we've all said that to ourselves.
Sure, of course. And sometimes the things that I've done have been trashy things, you know? But so there's some, you know, self-care that you've got to go in there and books, authors have helped me. I've had teachers along the way, one of them being my mom, that have helped me kind of come a little closer to full circle. And as a parent, I think that vulnerability has been one of my best tools so far. Just not even pretending for a second to be perfect, because my son is the opposite of my husband and I, of his dad, because my husband is not Henry's dad. Henry's dad, his name is Mark. My husband's name is Stephen, if that helps in the conversation. But Mark and I are great friends. He's one of my best friends. And
like, Henry's dad.
Right. And so that's a huge blessing and something we've worked on. It's something that didn't just, you know, come out of nowhere. But none of us are like Henry. Henry is very stoic and serious. Yeah. And he's really into languages. He's into learning Russian and Spanish. And he's just a different kind of person. And it's not that he's not creative. He's just not driven by the same things we are. Mm-hmm. And so I've said to him before many times, think about that. You were given parents. You were given this structure that's opposite of who you are. Like, what do you think that means God has for you or wants you to learn in life? You're in a bank with a bunch of clowns. I mean, that just came off the top of my head.
That's really funny and true, probably. Yeah. He might feel that way.
Does he perceive it?
I think he does. Yeah. And I've said before, you know, I'm sorry. There is nothing I can do about my personality other than be really aware of myself and try as hard as I can to be aware of your needs and be sensitive and be vulnerable. And
But I don't think any of us grew up wanting our parents to be, like, I now look, the differences between my parents and me are what actually bond us together still to this day.
That's wonderful to know.
I don't have children, so I can't speak into this from that personal experience, but being a child of parents who I still am in a relationship with, I think y'all will be such great friends.
That's wonderful. I hope so. He's my favorite person in the whole world.
You just want to be his favorite person.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's not the case.
You know what? I'm sure he does.
I know.
What's not to adore about you?
Well,
you seem
lovely. I agree with you.
I know.
But I know he appreciates my color, and I do. It's not his thing.
The way you see things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I know that he does. He appreciates it. And I know he appreciates his stepdad. I know he loves his dad. They're going to Iceland the day after tomorrow, their first, like, dude trip.
Cool.
Is his dad vulnerable? Is your husband vulnerable?
He really is.
See, my dad, you made me think of something, because I don't remember my dad saying I'm sorry but one time.
Really?
To me. Hmm. When he thought I said S-H-I-T.
Oh,
but
dear.
I didn't.
But you didn't?
I was four. I'll never forget it. I said, shoot.
And he thought he said
my face.
Oh,
really?
And said, and then, "You don't say that word." And I said, "I didn't." And he apologized.
He apologized.
But that's interesting, because that's an apology based on your behavior rather. Well, it is. You know what I mean? That's kind of convoluted, right?
It's only one I remember. I was four.
Yeah, I remember. Conversely, I remember my dad. I remember that being very important, because I'm very, I think, stubborn, you know, and I don't like to be wrong. And so it has given me a leg up that my dad apologized for things growing up.
Right.
In real time.
I think that's the most powerful thing a father could do, is to show vulnerability to their child. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I was at a church one time years ago, and I saw a poster that kind of reminds me of that. It said, the greatest gift a father can give to their child is to love their mother. Which I thought was so powerful.
Very powerful.
But also, that whole thing of, you know, the fact that I remember the one time, my gosh, what an impact that would have on children.
I know, mm-hmm. And you were only...
Do you think about that as a parent? Like, do you wonder sometimes when y'all have some kind of thing?
Shake up?
Yeah, are you like, oh my gosh.
What do y'all shake up over?
Shake up for life?
Well, I'm trying to think of the last time if it's something I can even talk about.
Sure.
Things got pretty real in Texas a few times. but yeah, I had to apologize to him. I mean, sometimes I'll get a little too rough because I'm really comfortable saying Henry Nash, and my tone is just, you know, it's like, it's just too abrasive. Mm-hmm. And I'm not really sure where that comes from, but it's like, there will be no, you know, BS.
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna, you know, toe the line. You're gonna do what I say. And sometimes I'm just too harsh. And my mom brought that to my attention.
Isn't he?
So I apologized.
Yeah, and when he was four, you probably had to do that. But now you're having to change your way of parenting too, right?
Very
much. As they age.
Very much. Give space, but make sure they know that you're right there. And I've only got the one child, so it's been hard for me to not be a helicopter parent. Mm-hmm. And so I'm learning to try to back off a little bit and also just make sure that he knows that I'm right there.
Sure.
So, and I've got to rely on God to help guide me through this.
Oh, yeah.
'Cause I'm not, I've never parented before. I've never had a son. I didn't have a brother. Other than my dad, who was kind of a brother.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks,
mm-hmm.
Thanks, Dad. Daddy, brother.
Daddy.
Brother, daddy.
I want to meet my daddy brother.
Buddy, come say hello to my daddy brother.
It's very New Braunfels, it feels like.
You can help save thousands of lives by giving a generous gift to Food for the Hungry today.
In the rural Dera district of Ethiopia, families are experiencing high death rates in children under 5 due to preventable water-related diseases. They simply don't have access to clean water sources or the infrastructure to practice good health and hygiene.
Until now, we're talking latrines, Andrew. Your gift today will provide families in the Dera district with clean water, health and hygiene training, hand washing stations, and life-saving latrines. And to add to the impact, your gift will be matched 22 times. 22 times.
It's a wonderful opportunity, Mark. Food for the Hungry is already laying the groundwork now to provide a safe place to live for hundreds of thousands of vulnerable children and their families in Ethiopia. I think of Jesus' own words in the Gospels where he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. The people of Ethiopia, Mark, they matter to God, and so they matter to us too. Will you help us let them know they are important to God and to their neighbors across the ocean? That's us.
Give generously today at fh.org/dinner. We're so excited that you'll be giving, that we want to give something to you. We have several add-ons, we call them, where we will be maybe making a special phone call to a friend of yours, a video.
Some little videos, that's right. It's shout-out videos for your friend's birthday, for an anniversary, or maybe like a Zoom conversation with just you, Mark, and me, or even a Zoom party with you and some of your friends. All these are just a simple way to say thank you for the life-saving gift that you're giving to Food for the Hungry for our friends in Ethiopia at fh.org/dinner. All right, so Caroline Breen, which we are in, we're on set of Dinner Conversations.
Yes.
Because that's your home.
Yeah, it is. My room's right down there.
All right, that's right. I remember the first day that we ever filmed any episodes in season one. Mm-hmm. And I think you were sick that day from school, right?
I was.
So you're back
sick
there the whole
week. Yeah.
Did we make you sick?
No, but I remember someone came over and I was like, what is that? Because they were really loud.
Shonda Pierce. Yeah. So, but you were in middle school, I think. So if you think about it, you've grown up in front of our eyes. Here you are. You're 18. You're an adult. Okay, so tell me something. What year were you born?
2002.
Okay, so 2002. I mean, that's amazing to me because I was in college in 2002. Mm-hmm. But what I think about is you guys that are becoming adults now, that are starting to go into college and even get into the workforce, are the first generation that are, you know, you grew up in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. Have you thought about that before?
Yes, a lot. Yeah. The whole social media.
Right.
Yeah.
Which I think a lot of people, because your generation has a lot of nicknames right now. I don't know what they'll finally land on, Gen Z or whatever, but iGen is one of them, right? Like an iPhone.
I haven't heard of that. I've only heard of Gen Z.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Well, iGen, I think, is another name for Gen Z. Chris doesn't know either. But what do you think about that? Like a lot of people from a cultural perspective, just like a broad stroke, will look at your generation and just think constant selfies, Snapchat, obsessed with themselves. How do you see your generation?
I see that because a lot of like social media, like TikTok and stuff, you're really trying to be creative and, you know, showcase your talents or what you're good at to get likes and followers and comments and stuff. But I also kind of see it as like we're creative in a way, and we're really advanced with technology where we know a lot of things. Like there are kids now who can pick up an iPad and know how to turn it on, and there are some adults who don't even know how to do that.
Sure.
So it's kind of, there's good and bad to it. If it depends what way you look at it.
Well, and with everything, right, it's about perspective. I see the good of it. Like, I've always loved being around generations. Now that I'm getting older,
right,
I like being around younger generations because I'm always learning something from them. I think that when we talk about generations, and my parents taught me this a long time ago, they really taught us to respect older generations when they were still younger and we were real little, but they also had people that were younger than them over. So we really learned how to interact with the different generations. Do you feel like it's important that we have relationships that cross generations?
Yes, because for me, when I'm applying for a job or something, I think it's really important to be able to have those conversations with people older. Or like if you go into a field with like teaching or anything, like also reaching out to younger generations and being able to make those connections with people, I feel like is really important. Being able to have a conversation with people who are older than you.
So tell me this, do you feel like sometimes there's this perspective of y'all's generation going to hell in a handbasket kind of thing? Is that your perspective?
Like, what do you mean?
I remember like that it's all hopeless. There's nothing positive about young people today.
I don't really see that. I think, like I said before, like there are so many of my friends who are so knowledgeable and like are going to do so many amazing things. And of course, there are some people who will sit on their phone 24/7 and do nothing, but I feel like that's kind of how it's been with other generations too.
Sure.
Like there, it kind of depends on how you're gonna live. Like, are you gonna go out and do something great and pursue what you're passionate about, or are you just gonna not pursue it, kind of do nothing? So I guess it's kind of the same as always. It's just how you look at it and how you handle it.
Absolutely. I heard someone the other day too talking about millennials, which is my generation, though I'm an old millennial. And they were saying how millennials kind of got a bad rap too about being real self-obsessed. But he said, actually, I see another perspective, because millennials was the first generation, and I think this carries into your generation too, where they were actually interested in what they do day to day for their bread and butter mattering in the future, being making a difference in the world around them. So I see that.
Yes.
In your generation, I don't think you're just concerned with yourself. You're very passionate and you're willing to pursue that passion, but you're also concerned about how it connects with the world around you. If there's one difference you can make in the world through your life, what would you hope that would be?
I'm thinking about maybe going into, this is like one of the fields that I might want to go into, possibly studying political science and stuff, because I feel like that whole news media is very, I don't know, I feel like it's very twisted right now. And I would love to, I think it'd be really interesting to work in that field and be able to deliver to audiences like the whole truth and, you know, really investigate certain situations and just be able to give like an honest take on things. Because right now, our country is kind of crazy. So
let's talk about your parents.
Okay.
All right. So let's talk about David and Shelley.
Okay.
Which we know, of course, you know, your mom's been on our show with her group Point of Grace, and your dad's worked in music for years. And so we've all kind of known each other. Of course, you've known them your whole life too. But what is your favorite part of about your parents? What's your favorite thing?
So for my mom, probably I've gotten a lot of opportunities because she's in Point of Grace and stuff when I was younger to go out and travel with her. So that was really fun, and just like watching her when I was really young and just getting to know her coworkers, Denise and Leigh, and their kids, and just being out with them. That was a really great way to grow up, and a great, you know, I have so many awesome memories from that time. So that's probably from my mom. And for my dad, I don't know. I feel like he's just a really kind person, and he can tolerate, like, there are so many times when he'll come home from work with, like, stories, and me and my mom are like, how do you tolerate that? Mm. And he's just, you know, he's kind of lets it go and just, like, doesn't even, I don't know, he doesn't really invest in drama, I feel like, so that's something that I look up to. I guess.
And hope to incorporate in your life. That would be good if a lot of us incorporated less drama in our life.
Right.
Especially in 2021, right?
Yes.
Yeah, we've had enough drama probably for all of our lifetimes.
So true.
You know, one thing that I remember about my parents and my dad especially is that really impacted me is that he would apologize. When he had sincerely done something wrong or made a mistake, he would come to me even when I was a kid and apologize, which to me expressed a certain humility, even though he was my elder, he was my parent, and I was, you know, I believe in honoring my mother and father and respecting them, but it produced a different dynamic between us where I could really trust my dad because he was willing to take responsibility for what was his. And it made me want to take responsibility for what was mine instead of try to skirt the truth. What's a lesson that you feel like you've learned? Or what's a way, do you have an example of something that you're like, you know, that made my dad or my mom a human to me in a good way?
Probably just like the daily sacrifices that they make for me, like just them even sending me to the school that I go to, which I know that's a really big financial sacrifice for them, and just them doing everything that they possibly can do for my needs and my interests. And when I was younger, taking me from piano lessons to sports practice, whatever sport I was playing at the time, you know, just all those sacrifices that they made for me day to day, and my mom like cooking for me and stuff.
Like, your mother is a good cook.
Right.
You're lucky.
Yes.
Do you think you'll miss some of those little things like your mom's cooking and stuff when you go to college?
Yes, but if COVID keeps up, I probably will be home.
You're hoping for another? I don't know that they're hoping for that.
Maybe, I don't know.
Okay, tell me, what is your hope, just from where you're sitting today, what is your hope for the world around you?
Probably to become more unified and be able to have conversations with people who maybe don't agree with you, because I know right now in the political and social climate that we're in, I think it's hard to be able to connect with people who maybe don't share the same viewpoints as you on major topics, whether it be religion or politics or anything like that. So probably just being able to really sit down with one another and talk it out, and it's okay to not agree, but still being open to having those conversations.
Hmm. How do you think your faith plays into that perspective?
Probably just being able to, I don't know, like, that's, love is like the greatest commandment, and just being able to love your enemies. And there's this whole verse about like, love your enemies, pray for those who hurt you, and like, love those who mistreat you, like all those different things.
And, and it's been true forever, right? I think it's always been countercultural and even to some degree, not the most intuitive human thing to do, right? To love someone that hurts you.
Yes.
But what we're learning and seeing is it can be one of the most powerful things.
It's true.
Can it? And you get to exercise that even with your friends.
Yes, yes.
I'm sure you can think of someone who may have hurt you. And you know what? And someone who you've hurt. And to be able to exercise love in spite of that could make the world a different place, huh?
Yes, 100%.
So you've obviously, in your friendships with your peers and being over at your friends' houses, et cetera, you've seen their parents, their parents' relationships with them, and you have a relationship with your parents. How important is it that parents try to relate to their kids, not just as a disciplinarian, that's important too, but as someone who's also a guide, a mentor, and in some ways also a friend?
I think it's important to have a really good relationship, like from the parent's perspective, with your kid, but not so like not overly protective, if that makes sense. Because I've seen instances where when the parent gives the child more freedom, then they will go off and do crazy things. But I've also seen parents that I don't know, I've seen it from both sides. Like, if a parent is really overprotective, mm-hmm. you have some kids, 50% of them will be scared out of their mind and don't want to do anything crazy to upset the parent. But then you have the other 50% that want to do the total opposite of what mm-hmm. their parent is saying because it's so exhausting and they just want to rebel, mm-hmm. I guess you could say.
It's like what I hear you saying is parents, trust your kids before you distrust them, maybe?
Yes, yes.
And that's harder said than done. Mm-hmm. I'm a parent and I see all that's going on around the world and I see some of my kids' friends too. And I'm like, who's influencing her? Who's she buying into? That kind of thing. It can be real hard. But don't you think parents trusting kids first gives them a foundation of kind of security and confidence to make potentially good decisions?
Yes, yes. And if something doesn't go well, that's when you can, you know, you can learn that lesson of, okay, this was wrong. I'm not going to do it again or else there will be consequences. But also, I have the freedom to, you know, do what I want and potentially make right decisions without feeling like weighed down with, you know, rules and restrictions and pressure.
I was talking to my parents more recently because I have two older brothers, so there's three of us, and we all really like hanging out with my parents to this day as adults. Mm-hmm. And I have other friends who I grew up with who, you know, they don't have that kind of kinship with their parents. And so I asked my parents, I said, is there something you did in parenting that you felt like really developed that? And they're very observant people, but pretty humble. And they were just like, you know, y'all just turned out. And I was like, well, you had to have influenced us somehow. Yeah. We definitely grew up in your household. You know, they were present. And my dad said something that I thought was interesting and is reiterating some of what you're saying. He said, you know, we decided very early on in our parenting journey that you guys would have the freedom to fail and succeed. And those failures were your failures and the successes were your successes. So when you divinely screwed up on something, mm-hmm. you know, you had a safe place at home to come land and to face those consequences and to talk about it and to hurt and to grieve those things. And sure, we might be, I don't even know if they use the word disappointed, but we would walk on in that journey of frustration and consequences with you. At the same time, when you succeeded, when you did something really fantastic, that was your success. We celebrate alongside you, but we did not take that for you.
Yeah.
You know, so we both have seen, we all have seen parents who are so integrated in unhealthy ways in their children's lives that their children are unable to develop into their own people. Mm-hmm. So I would say, seeing you, have been parented that largely you've been able to develop into your own person.
Yes.
For better, for worse.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, that's right. The verdict is still out.
Perfect.
The Bible is the foundation of our theology. We would not know of Jesus if it weren't for the Bible. We wouldn't know about grace. We wouldn't know about how God cares for us. And there is a new Bible out called the Abide Bible. You know how Jesus said, if you abide in me as I abide in my Father, and we abide in each other, and it's just a continual feed off each other. And what I like about this Bible is it's asking us to go deeper.
Yeah, it's taking an approach to the Bible from being just simply informational to really being invitational. So there's a lot of prompts in this Bible to journal alongside scriptures. It gives you opportunity to pray certain scriptures at different seasons of your life, to meditate on the scripture. There's beautiful artwork in here that's really cool because it's not just like some kind of Sunday school artwork. They're using like Da Vinci and beautiful pieces
and
of plastic
Van Gogh
to really just get us to imagine, to be able to use all of our senses as we enter into scripture so that we really step into the story of scripture, not just see it as words on a page, but as part of a living, breathing, active part of our lives. And you know what? I asked my brother one time who's a pastor, I said, why is the Bible so important? And he said, exactly what you said a second ago, because it is the greatest written revelation of who God is. And so it gives us the opportunity to know God, but also to be a part of God's story. That's the Abide Bible.
So go to abidebible.com to get your copy today. Did you know that at dinner-conversations.com, we have a store?
We have been around long enough to produce products.
That you want.
You want this, a dinner conversations mug to hold your 8 ounces of coffee in the morning
it's
or less.
Big.
And then one, if you want to look at us, see how intellectual I look with my glasses.
You look like you're judging me.
Well, I am. It gives me that intellectual look.
We also have DVDs full of all of our episodes and a bunch of bonus content you can't find anywhere else. We've got the season one DVD with all kinds of guests like Sandy Patty and Shonda Pierce and Point of Grace. And we've got this season two DVD set. I mean, these are tons of discs. Kathy Lee Gifford, Montel Jordan, Scott Hamilton, Amy Grant, and you know what else we have?
What?
We have the songs from the set CD where we sing a little bit together, but also you'll hear a lot of songs from people like Russ Taff and the Isaacs, some of our very favorites. You can find all of that at dinner-conversations.com.
I was thinking, okay, about thinking some about career, about Sixpence and the Richer, and when you and Matt Slocum, your partner in that, you know, began, you were around 14, 15, right? So you're around Henry's age. And I'm thinking about, even though, well, you got, I just
would
think
you
about,
let him up and move away?
Yeah, think about your lifestyle as a 15-year-old.
I would, if it were the same circumstances, because I didn't move away at that age, but my mom and dad did start letting me travel with Matt Slocum and go off, drive up to Dallas for the night and drive back. And Matt, at the time, it's probably gotten a little better, a little bit of a narcolept. So we'd be driving back and I would have to be ultra alert because the truck would start veering off and be like, dude, I've got to be at school in the morning. Please don't let me die right now.
Yeah, wow.
But they trusted Matt. Matt's wonderful and has always been a good brother type friend. So,
but you know, that's even, I don't know if this day and age I would let my daughter go off with any adult man.
That's an interesting.
Well, yeah. And he was still, Matt didn't ever seem like much of an adult, especially at that age. And it wasn't.
Well, that's even worse.
He wasn't immature, sure. But he just had a very responsible innocence about him. Mm-hmm. My mom knew his parents.
Yeah.
He wasn't a typical teenager. Mm-hmm. He was 5 years older than me.
You didn't end up on
very
forensic
serious.
Files, so that's good.
No. No, I don't know how close, though. He may have had intentions to murder me a few times. Maybe that's why he was pulling off the road. But no, I don't think so. He was very much a gentleman always. And you know, he just was really into the band and motivated. And I think my family knew that if it wasn't music,
what would it be that you would get your hands into?
What's going to happen to her? Yeah.
What's going to happen to her?
I mean, that's a good point, though, seeing music as a direction that gave you outlets to express yourself, angst, emotions.
You could do comedy.
Oh, I would have loved to be a comedian. But that has had to, you know, I've sharpened that stick.
Yeah.
My funny stick.
Yeah.
Over the years on stage, being really awkward and dealing with stage fright, that's
fantastic.
Made it funny. So,
Are you still doing concerts?
Very much, all the time.
Really? Do you still experience stage fright?
I do.
After all these years,
I have. That's
really?
Why I'm in therapy.
Are you funny on stage?
I believe so.
Do you take a band?
I have been traveling with my husband, but the thing about him is he's a songwriter and he's become Mr. Big Britches. And it only happened in the last year and a half, and all of a sudden he's Mr. I write with Tom Douglas every week. That hurt my feelings because I thought Tom and I had something.
Right. And you've probably written with Tom before, haven't
twice.
You?
Twice.
Yeah.
And then you've been, you know, it's like she's just writing for herself. We're not writing any Miranda Lambert cuts. But Steven's like, he's an amazing songwriter. And now he's starting to do artist stuff and he's incredible. And I don't want to get in the way of that.
That's
so
true.
I'm going to have to take someone else out. And I've got a guy that travels with Over the Rhine and they're really busy.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
when they're not busy, I'm going to steal him.
Yeah. Now, is it a guitar player? Is
he's amazing.
So you just take a guitar player?
Mm-hmm. Me and a guitar player.
Well, your voice.
Yeah. I would love it to be. And that's also helped me hone the humor craft a little bit and the banter between songs. And I do get the comment a lot. Like, I feel like I just, you know, got a comedy show and a music and I cried all in one ticket. And I was like, yeah, that's right. So when I don't hear that, I feel like I didn't do a good job.
It's like a roller coaster. Yeah. You take them here, you go up here. I've watched Gaither do it. I've watched other people do it. The masters.
Right.
They'll take you on a ride.
It's wonderful.
Well, life's a ride.
It's an art.
And the more life you experience, the more ride you're going to offer other people. What did you learn that is now influencing how you raise a teenager?
From all that I experienced, I think just how big life is, how big it can be, how much you can do. Because I've definitely got out of New Braunfels. I mean, I've seen the world, and I've seen the kindness of people. And I'm really proud of Henry that he's interested in languages, because that will open up your world quicker than I think anything else. And I would love, you know, maybe it doesn't matter what I would love for him, because he's supposedly not mine. He's God's, which I really, that's a tough. That takes my breath away.
I love that, supposedly.
Supposedly.
I love that.
Definitely feels like he's mine, but I really try to let
He's on loan. Don't you hate that?
But I want him to, but I feel like, yeah, what I learned is just how big the world can be, and not to put people in boxes, and just be in awe.
Twilight, lead me out on the moonlit floor. Lift
There's a mutual friend of ours, Andrew Osenga, and I was listening. Actually, we both listened to his interview with you on his podcast, which is great.
I had such a good time talking to him.
Yeah, he's such a tender spirit.
And he's a good interviewer.
He is. He doesn't go these places.
He did a great job.
Does. But y'all were talking about worry. And it may have been, I remember you said something in the context of raising kids that that's enough to give you worry, tears, enough for the, you know, make the world go around. But you said you were trying to learn not to worry. Mm-hmm. And worry seems like such an innate part of our humanity. Right. You know, how have you begun? I don't even know what it means to learn not to worry. Like, what is that exercise for you?
Well, I wrote something on my husband's birthday card just a few days ago. He turned 40. And this is a Buddha quote. And I hope that's okay that I bring that up. Yeah. And I just happened to find it the night before in a book. But it said something, and I wish I knew the exact quote, but maybe y'all can look it up later.
We have it.
We have those abilities, though.
Did you find it in the Bible?
It was a Buddha quote in the Bible. Yeah, it's in, I think it's in Leviticus.
Wow.
But anyway, but it talks about, and this does have to do with worry, that all the stuff's going to happen, loss, pain, passion, loss of passion, tragedy, all of it's going to happen in your life. It's going to happen. Mm-hmm. There's nothing you can do. So you may as well take it like the mighty oak, mm-hmm. and just be like a big tree. And you suffer it, but you also get to watch it all happen and you get to grow. Think about a tree. You know, mm-hmm. a tree doesn't just stand still, it grows. Mm-hmm. And there was a movie that came out a couple years ago. I'll think of the title in a second. It's a beautiful movie, but there was a quote in it about how the tree bent, but it still grew. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was also so sweet. And I know there's been so many, you know,
tree planted by the water. There's a scripture in Psalms about mm-hmm. that, too.
Mm-hmm. You had to bring it back to the Bible, didn't you?
Well, did I? I did, of course.
But the Bible is, I mean, it is the richest source for...
Oh, absolutely.
I know that God could have just put that Buddha quote down.
Sure.
It just happened.
And who knows, you know, the thing is, hey.
And Stephen appreciated it. It really meant a lot
well,
to him.
Well, I do...
I don't put anything past God.
Does that make any sense?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would not put a thing past God, and that's what makes me worry.
Yeah, I don't put anything past him.
But I know that the strength, the net underneath will be there.
Yeah.
And it's terrifying, and I've seen a lot of stuff.
So far, so good.
He's precious.
He seems to be.
He is. He is. I mean, you know, he's got his lot of rough edges.
Three more years and you're done.
I don't even start with me.
Don't even start.
He's in Russia. In three years, he's in Russia.
So as terrifying as it has been.
Yeah. Did he just leave?
You don't want it.
He just ran away.
He's like,
thanks, guys.
Okay. As terrifying, you talked about worry, right?
Right.
So you will. That will continue probably until you pass away.
Your heart's outside your body for the rest of your life.
Right, because it's the center of this child. But yet you've let go. You've got to let him go a little at a time, right?
Right.
So how's that going?
Now, I always say, you know, when you become pregnant, you're not ready to have an infant. You have 9 months to become ready to have an infant. So it's the same thing when you're raising a child. You're not ready when they're 10 or 15 to let him go, but maybe at 18.
What would you like that relationship to be like one day? I mean, when it finally is ready. I mean, it's done. When you're done, you'll never be done, but you know what I'm saying.
When he's 30.
Yeah, what do you see when he's 30?
I would just love him to be fulfilled in the way that he is meant to be filled, with whatever that is, knowledge, wisdom, whatever I was able to impart. I would really love for him to have a healthy relationship, good friendships, healthy boundaries. But he's his own man. I don't know anybody like Henry. I don't know anybody like him.
Isn't that cool? So
it is cool in that I'm going to have to rely on God to let go, because I don't know how in this body to do it. I don't know how. So I just have to, Richard Rohr is going to have to keep writing books. And I'm going to have to keep listening to him in my car.
Well, Richard Rohr. Listen to that voice.
Ah.
there's something to that.
To Richard Rohr's voice?
No, listen to the voice of God.
Right.
You know, get quiet. Mm-hmm. I'm just literally learning this myself at 61. I've heard about it, but I've never actually done it until recently. And I think there's something to it.
What, be quiet?
Be quiet and listen. You know, someone asked Mother Teresa, when you pray, what do you say? She said, oh, I don't say anything. I listen. Mm-hmm. Well, what does God say? He doesn't say anything. He listens. Now, that is a little odd for me.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, but I think so far for me, it's I get quiet, but he's still talking.
Right.
Or something in my brain still talking. Mm-hmm. And let those pictures pass in front of your eyes and say, okay, is this what you want me to do today, Lord? Mm-hmm. Is this thought of you? Is this, you know, because he said, my sheep know my voice. And he said, call on me and I'll answer you. And so I'm learning to just literally do that and then be quiet.
Right.
And see what happens.
I mean, if I think about my ultimate desire, it's just, you know, like my constant prayer is, God, will you just not leave me? You know, will you just be like my companion? Yeah, yeah. I really want companion. Don't we all? Yeah. That's why we get married. That's why we date. That's why we have best friends, is because we want someone just to be with us.
Right.
And not ask a lot.
Right. Yeah. I'm very moved by this conversation and also, you know, by what you both said. And I think I'm just getting to the point of being quiet enough. And I love things turning on their end. Does that make sense? Like things you always thought meant one thing. Mm-hmm. And then it flips.
Yes.
And I was singing a song that Matt Slocum, my partner in Sixpence, wrote, called The Melody of You. And there's another song called Breathe Your Name. And both of those songs recently, and I need to talk to him about it, but he's not going to know. I mean, he wrote them.
That's funny. But
it feels, The Melody of You is like a love letter to God. And then Breathe Your Name, in the same sense, is sort of a love letter to God, or just you're in my head. I can feel you. I can feel you. You're steering everything. And I just, as I've been singing those songs the last few months, started to turn around. Like, what if this is also the way God loves us? Like, what if that's how God felt about Matt? And maybe part of it's true, maybe not the whole song, but little pieces of it just break my heart. When I think about, I always thought, oh, okay, well, I was the voice. The lyrics and melody of you are, you're the scent of an unfound bloom. You're the scent of an unfound bloom, a simple tune. I only write variations to a drink that will knock me down on the floor, a key that will unlock the door where I hear a voice sing familiar things and beckons me weave notes in between. And I always thought, well, I'm the voice. But no, I think that it's so much deeper. And I think God, I don't know,
He wants us to sing harmony with Him.
Yeah.
That's what I hear in that lyric.
So much.
He invites us to join the song.
Yeah.
That's
There's
beautiful.
There's just so many layers
to
everything in life and what we're willing to look at and what we're willing to meditate on and be quiet enough to actually, you know, here.
And we're so layered, and we're reflections of God. He must be layered too.
Oh, yeah.
And surely that's not the worst thing in the world, you know?
No, that's the mystery that I think we don't, the longer we get the pleasure of being here is the more that mystery maybe gets revealed, and it's stunning. My grandmother is 96, and I just got to spend a month, you know, washing her clothes and changing her sheets.
In New Braunfels?
Talking to her. And the last conversation we had, yeah, she lives in New Braunfels. She's in an assisted living place. But I talked to her the night before I left, and she said, I love you, and I pray for you every day. And she said, and all I can say is you're supposed to tell God what you need. Ask Him for what He wants for you, and He's supposed to tell you. And that's all she said. That was all. And I have a feeling. I mean, I don't know. She doesn't understand why she's still here. So I'm going to be at peace that she's at peace whenever she's taken. But it felt like maybe our last conversation. I'm gonna call her in a minute. Doesn't have to be.
Right.
We could have the last one right here on camera, actually.
Wow. Let's call her right now. So funny. You just give her permission to die.
Her mansion's not ready.
Oh, and this is fun. This is funny as all get out. Henry and I and she were in a room. My mom was talking to her brother on the phone. So my grandmother is now alive. She's got two kids left. One passed away a few years ago, but they were on the phone. And Ma looked over and she goes, "Don't ever get old, honey. Don't ever get old." And I said, "Well, I don't want to die young.
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of like to get old." And she said, "Henry doesn't want you to."
Henry doesn't want you to. That is hysterical.
And I looked at Henry and he was like,
yeah, wants to go on and lay down, right?
Thank you for watching Dinner Conversations. Don't forget to subscribe and then ring that bell and get all notifications.
And don't forget to like us or dislike us.
No,
don't do that. Leave comments, talk about what's resonating in your life from these conversations, and join us next time for Dinner Conversations with
Mark Lowry
and Andrew Greer.
Turning the light on.
One question at a time.
Dinner Conversations is brought to you by Food for the Hungry, an incredible relief and community development organization serving those with physical and spiritual needs around the world for 50 years this year.
Help us as we help our friends at Food for the Hungry save thousands of lives in Ethiopia today by considering a generous gift.
A gift that will be matched 22 times.
Your one-time gift will make an eternal difference. So visit fh.org/dinner to give now.